Iron deficiency without anemia?
Hi, I'm Chris Masterjohn, and I have a PhD in nutritional sciences. I am not a medical doctor, and nothing contained in this episode may be construed as medical or nutritional advice of any kind, or a substitute, therefore. This episode is meant purely as scientific education. If you wish to act on any ideas presented in this episode, please consult your physician first, and never take anything herein as a reason to contradict medical advice. With that said, enjoy the episode.
Alicia C. says, what do you make of iron deficiency without apparent anemia? Those are fireworks. Okay. Iron deficiency without apparent anemia. Before I read the rest of your question, I would just say that I would be wary of iron deficiency, even if it's not causing anemia, because iron plays roles in energy metabolism, detoxification, and thyroid metabolism, separate from anemia. But the things that are easiest to test are thyroid panel and CBC. So if your thyroid panel and your CBC look great, you probably aren't truly iron deficient. But I would also measure it against symptoms. So for example, if you have unexplained fatigue and you feel much better when you get more iron in your diet, I would interpret that as iron deficiency. That probably is just most sensitively affecting the electron transport chain if it's, you know, not showing up in a CBC or a thyroid panel. Okay, so continuing the question, Alicia says, in over a decade of tests, RBCs, hemoglobin, hematocrit, and MCH have never been near the bottom of the range. MCV has been in the mid-90s and RDW hangs around mid-range. In contrast, my ferritin has been in the teens and 20s and iron saturation was once 14%. None of my doctors cared because of the lack of blatant anemia. I wish I could easily share the fireworks outside the window. Living in the city, it's all June, all of June through July 4th. So in contrast, my ferritin has been in the teens. None of the doctors cared because of lack of blatant anemia. I couldn't get ferritin or saturation to budge until learning from you that inadequate riboflavin could be involved. Since supplementing riboflavin using ancestral spleen, iron, bisglycinate, and dietary iron has gotten iron up some in my is my situation unusual? In case you're interested, recent labs, and just goes over the numbers that generally support what she was just saying. Most recently, transferrin saturation was 20.7%, iron saturation was 24%, and serum iron was 79%, red blood cells, hemoglobin, hematocrit are all in range. I would revert back to what I was saying before. If this is not showing up in a CBC and it's not showing up in a thyroid panel and you feel great, it's probably nothing to worry about. But it does sort of imply that your iron stores are on the edge and you could become anemic and you'd be much more vulnerable to becoming anemic than you would be if your iron stores were higher. So I do think it makes sense to try to increase it, but the things that you would do to increase it wouldn't be any different from anyone else who's iron deficient. I don't think it's that interesting that, I mean, it's interesting, but I don't think it changes the situation much that you aren't becoming anemic. I think that just means that you have a very good rate of hemoglobin synthesis relative to your red blood cell turnover that is using your iron stores for that purpose very efficiently. If you are hypothyroid, then that changes things. And I would be trying to get the iron up to try to improve that. If you feel like your energy metabolism is sluggish and getting your iron levels up helps it, then I would continue to work on that. But if you feel great, CBC looks great, thyroid looks great, I wouldn't worry about trying to fix a current iron deficiency situation. But it wouldn't be a bad idea to try to improve your iron stores so that you're less vulnerable to becoming iron deficient and anemic in the future, or anemic or hypothyroid. I wouldn't do anything different than what we talked about, 2 weeks ago when we did an AMA, we had a whole like 20 minute ish talk about what to do when you're trying to supplement iron and it's not budging. Real quickly, riboflavin and copper, the two complementary nutrients to look at. You already mentioned looking at riboflavin. Higher dose, eating it with no plant foods and a carnivore rich meal are two other things you could look at besides absorption issues. That's my answer. So I hope that helped, Alicia.
This episode was part of a Q&A for members of the CMJ Masterpass, where I hold monthly private Zoom Q&As for my members. The Masterpass also serves as a buyer's club with exclusive and massive discounts on your favorite premium foods and health products, including pasture-raised and wild meat and seafood, supplements, sleep accessories, water filters, phototherapy devices, and much more. If you'd like to participate in these Q&As, you can join the Masterpass at chrismasterjohnphd.com/masterpass and use the code Q&A, spelled Q-A-N-D-A, Q&A, for 10% lifetime discount. I am currently working full-time on finishing my first book, Vitamins and Minerals 101, How to Get the Nutrients You Need on Any Diet. I will let you know when I have a release date. In the meantime, you can pre-order the book at chrismasterjohnphd.com/book. Testing Nutritional Status, the ultimate cheat sheet, has been newly released as version 1.3. This is my comprehensive system for managing nutritional status with lab tests, dietary analysis, and comprehensive intake of your signs and symptoms. The new version has a comprehensive guide to interpreting the Genova methylation panel. You can pick up your copy at chrismasterjohnphd.com/cheat sheet. In my consulting, I am neither a medical practitioner nor a coach. I serve as your data analyst and your strategist. I teach you scientific principles of health and wellness, help you analyze your data, and help brainstorm actionable strategies. You can sign up for a consultation at chrismasterjohnphd.com/consultations. Please consider supporting my work at no extra cost to you by visiting my support page and making a purchase with one of my affiliate links. Some of my most popular affiliates are also listed in the description of this video with links that will give me credit for your purchase. I will try to respond to comments when I can, but my presence will be intermittent while I'm finishing my book. I hope you enjoyed this, and I will see you in the next episode.